All right, buddy. So this is going to be the second part of our Btrfs tutorial. In this video, we're going to talk about Btrfs raids and some of the advanced capabilities that Btrfs has with raids. So what we're going to do is we are going to create a raid. We are going to just start off with one disk. We're going to add a second disk. We're going to change the raid level on the fly without remounting or anything. Then we're going to add two more disks onto our raid, and then change the raid level again without remounting or doing anything goofy. And then also after that, I'll show you just some small maintenance stuff that you can do with Btrfs, and something really cool with how quickly you can copy things because Btrfs is copy on write. So first off, like, what are some of the reasons you want to be able to use Btrfs for a raid? Well, for one, you can add disks and change your raid levels on the fly without remounting. So again, that lets us go from our one disk raid one to two disk raid one to like a four disk raid 10 without having to do any kind of goofy stuff, and we can just be adding disks right into our server. You can also even just, if you know you have enough space, you can even take disks out, which is really cool. No other file system that I'm aware of lets you take disks out of a raid. Another really cool thing is that it's self-healing. So again, if we have like a two disk raid one and you are, you know, grabbing a file off of one of the disks and Btrfs, you know, checks the checksum of the file and realizes that the file is corrupt, it'll actually grab the file from the other disk and then transparently in the background rewrite that file back onto the original disk and mark those sectors as bad. Another really cool thing is that it will do snapshotting, so that'll let you do like revisioning and a whole bunch of other stuff. We'll talk about snapshotting probably in my third video. Another cool thing is that it has extended attributes by default. So you can make, like, if you're serving up for a server or something like that from a particular directory, you can make files immutable and all that kind of cool stuff. So anyways, let's just get started. Here is our image from last time. I did add some disks and a few other packages just kind of like make my life a little bit easier. So you can see we have our four disks, SDB through SDE. So let's just go ahead and put Btrfs on one of our disks. So mkfs.btrfs tag L. Let's call it the pool. And let's see, B. I think I do have to toss in a tag F flag because I was messing around here earlier. So tag F is just force. So there we go. So we have our first disk. So if we were to mount dev /db/mount, and I did create a folder, I believe. Yep, for the pool. So now let's just go ahead and make our single partition right on the, or not single partition, our single subvolume right on the disk. So btrfs subvolume create the pool. Cool, and made it. So now let's unmount and then remount with our mount options in our subvolume. So, cd/mount, cool. You have to make it in the right directory, cd out. Okay, cool, so you mount, cool, and now mount tag O slash, so this is our transparent compression that we go for. Now, with an SSD, you can do the LZO compression, which is faster for solid state, but Zlib is more for archiving. It's not really so much. You will get a little bit of a speed boost out of it, but it's more about actually saving space on it, on the storage medium. Let's subvol equals the pool, and I also like to throw in auto defrag. Btrfs is a fragmenting file system because it is copy on write. So by nature of copy on write, it is fragmenting files. So auto defrag just says in the background, whenever you're not busy writing or reading anything, why don't you just go ahead and auto defrag, you know, the file system for us. That's pretty cool. So let's now mount this. Let's sdb slash mount the pool. Cool. So now if we run block, we can see we are mounted. And if we do btrfs file system show slash mount the pool, we can see we have one device in our pool with the that UUID, which is actually what you would put into the your like FS tab when you're mounting and all that kind of stuff. So that's a good place to know like where you get that, and the size and used and everything like that. So cool. Now let's why don't we just go ahead and add another device into our pool. So btrfs device add slash dev dc slash mount the pool. Oh, and I need tack f. Cool. So now we should have, if we do that again, we now have our two devices in the pool. Now you'll notice though that the chunks are not balanced. So basically, we're not balanced right now. You know, we have information on one. Now, actually, we don't have any information on there, but basically, Btrfs has freed up enough chunks on one device, and then it hasn't done anything on the other one. That's okay. Btrfs will like sort it out when there's nothing on there, but in case you already had something on there, you can balance it out at this point. Now, of course, right now, if we look at like the RAID level, it's not in a RAID level right now. Right now, it's in what's called single mode, which means that it is like putting, you know, one file on this device, and then when you know, write another file, maybe it'll put it on this device, maybe it'll put it on that device. You know, it'll basically just using all of the storage. So if you had mismatching sizes, it's using as much of that space as possible. It's not actually RAIDing it. So if we can actually find that information by issuing TRFS file system df, right? So data single, system isn't dupe, and metadata isn't dupe. So dupe is just duplication, so it's putting in both disks, but the data is still in single. So how do we convert into a RAID 1? Very simple. Btrfs file system, is it balance? Yeah, file system balance start tack b convert RAID 1 tack. I also like to put the metadata in RAID 1. Usually Btrfs would handle this for us and just put in dupe. I kind of like RAID 1 though. So tack mconvert RAID 1 slash mount. Cool, and there we go. So, just like that, no unmounting, no like, you know, doing anything goofy. We just added another device and rebalanced our RAID. So if we actually look at our DF, you can see our data is in RAID 1, our system is in RAID 1, our metadata is in RAID 1. Cool, awesome. Now, let's just go ahead and add two more disks onto our file system and rebalance to RAID 10. So btrfs add dev dd slash mount the pool. Cool. So again, if we btrfs file system show slash mount, you can see we have our four devices. Again, nothing is on the two devices that we just added because it's not balanced. It's an unbalanced RAID right now. But when we issue our command to balance our file system in the RAID 10, it'll automatically balance it out for us. So btrfs file system, btrfs file system, convert RAID. Tack equals RAID 10 mount and done. Simple as that, right? So now if we go back and see, we are now balanced. And if we do a BF slash mount the pool, there we go. We are in raid 10. It is literally as simple as that. So if you ever were to find any of your data just to be unbalanced for some reason, if you were to look at the Btrfs file system show command and data was for some reason spread weird on a few disks, you can always just do Btrfs file system balance start slash mount the pool, right? And it will balance the file system. Now, of course, we don't have a lot of space here. These are only like 1 gig disks because this is, you know, just a virtual box image. If you had a lot of data, these processes could actually take a while. Mine, I have a 5 disk RAID 10 in my basement, and going from 4 disks to 5 disks on a RAID 10, it took about a week to rebalance. So it does take a while. And those were with, you know, some pretty nice, they were only 5,400 RPM, but pretty nice, 4 terabyte drives and two quad core processors on the motherboard. So eight cores running on that beast. So yeah, let's see what else. Oh, if every once in a while, like I said, Btrfs is a self-healing file system. So if it does see that you are accessing a file that is bad, on bad sectors, it can rebuild it from the other copies on the RAID. But if you wanted to just in the background, scrub the data and restore a lot of that stuff without having to worry about Btrfs doing that for you automatically in the background, making sure that you have both copies on there, you can always add a cron job to do this, but you can also run it manually. So Btrfs scrub start. Cool. And you can see it starts in the background, so I'll automatically kick back my terminal. I don't have to worry about that. I can always also just, instead of issuing start, right, I can always just issue status. Sometimes, actually, if I'm running a big scrub, like I run the scrub manually on my server, I'll actually just have this up on a terminal and just kind of like watching it and see what it's doing. And you can see that was really pretty quick, given that we don't have any data and that, you know, we have small disks. So again, like on my server, it can take like 12 hours, and I have probably 16 terabytes of raw data on my RAID, so quite a lot of stuff there. What else? Oh, if we were to not mount our RAID with auto defrag, we can actually run defragmentation in the background as well. So again, Btrfs file system defragment slash mount. I think maybe I have to start pool. Nope, no start. Boom. And again, that'll just run in the background. You don't have to worry about it. But now I want to show you some like cool feature of Btrfs that, you know, some people know about, not too many people know about. So this is, let's create a 1 gigabyte file. So cd slash, let's go into our RAID. So let's truncate tfs mg. Cool, so as you can see, I actually just made a 1 gigabyte file on our file system just as a test file. So usually, like if you had a really big file, like multiple gigs, like, you know, I backed up a lot of my Blu-ray movies on my RAID, and some of the movies are like 40 gigabytes. And if you needed to copy some of these files or move them, that can actually take, you know, a minute or 2 minutes or whatever to move that many blocks. Well, because Btrfs is copy on write, what you can actually do is say, leave that file on the disk where it is, and then just update the super block at the head of the disk to say, that the file that lives in this directory and the file that lives in this directory are the same, you know, and it'll just point to the same data, right? So how you do this is you'd use cp tatac ref link without the equals, and then your test, and then we make this test two. Bam, and it's instant, right? Because all we're doing, we're not rewriting that data over again, right? What we are saying is that this file lives here. Let's reference link it to this location as well, okay? So because of that, we're not moving the file. We're not doing anything. All we're doing is saying that it lives in both locations. So this also, this saves us a little bit of space on array, because if we had like a 40 gigabyte file or even larger, we're just saying this file lives in both locations. And it's not like a link either. It's actually like, as far as everything is concerned, that file exists twice. Just Btrfs knows that that file only exists in the one location, which is pretty cool. It's all just done in the background. Also, if you were to delete the original file, you're not going to delete the other one. So again, like if you were to link those two things and you delete the original file, well, that link wouldn't work anymore. But on Btrfs, because we are doing ref linking, it will actually work, because that second link will still be pointing to the original data. So that's pretty cool. So yeah, that is some of the more advanced features of Btrfs and some of the cool magical things that it'll do for your raids. There are a lot of cool things that like ZFS does as well. I won't really get too much into ZFS versus Btrfs raids. Personally, I think my opinion is that if you're running Linux, Btrfs is a little bit better, because ZFS is a little bit hacky under Linux. And I won't get into any of the reasons. There's a lot of political stuff, and you know, I'll probably get flamed on in the comments. But honestly, Btrfs for raid, dead stupid. Dead stupid easy to just do everything you possibly want. So cool. I think that'll be it for this video. In the next video, we'll take a look at some snapshotting stuff. And in the fourth video, we'll look at some of the weird gotchas that Btrfs has, like some weird storage stuff and everything. So cool. I think that'll be it for this one. Bye, guys.